Hello and welcome to our Alaskan Oasis Homeschool Collective, where we are on a mission to build a collective of global literacy coaches empowered with skills in direct instruction, precision teaching, PACS, and self-directed education. My name is Abigail Twyman, and thank you for joining us today. Today is Friday, November 19th, and this is our final workshop in the Finding Our Hearts workshop series. Today actually is the full beaver moon, and this is the time of the month, the moon cycle, during which we are making decisions. Today is Equal Opportunity Day, also known as the Gettysburg Address Day, Rocky and Bullwinkle Day, and World Toilet Day. My name is Abigail Twyman. We are here coming to you live from Klawak in the Voc Tech Center, the Prince of Wales Island Voc Tech Center in Klawak, Alaska. We are located in Tlingit Ani, which are the traditional homelands of the Tlingit, Haida, and Tsimshian people. We synchronize all of our work to the moon cycle, and which means that we have a kind of a different focus every part of the month. During the beginning of the month and the new moon, we set our intentions. During the first quarter of the first quarter moon, we are exploring opportunities. In the full moon section of the month, we are making decisions. And then in the final quarter moon, we are reflecting and resting and rejuvenating and preparing for the next month to come. I am a humanistic behavioral scientist, creative writer, and data-driven optimist, and we're on a mission to create a network of people who are also living by that same or similar life philosophies. So, Kunoshish, Hau'a, Tuxin, and thank you so much for being here today with us. As I mentioned, today is November 19th, it is the full beaver moon. And on the full moon, we have a journal prompt. And so I will read this journal prompt and give us 5 minutes to reflect and write about this prompt. The journal prompt for this time of the month is, I release the things that no longer serve me and that are preventing me from manifesting my intention. I am. For this journal prompt, we have a 5-minute free write. And if you are participating live, you are welcome to share if you are comfortable. But this is a good time for us to come together and take an opportunity to share some reflections with ourselves, get some things down on paper, and then move forward from there. All right, those are our 5 minutes for journaling. And so if you are wanting to share, or willing to share, you are welcome to. What I came up with, so one of my I am statements was, I am confident in my ability to consistently act in the service of my values, even when there are real or perceived barriers in my way. There is nothing I can't accomplish with the right mindset, and I choose to act with pride always. Awesome. All right, so our daily challenge for Friday, it's Full Bore Friday, and our fact of the week comes from this day in history. And the fact is that on this day in history, on November 19th, 1915, the state of Utah executed Joe Hill, who is a labor organizer, songwriter, and member of the Industrial Workers of the World. And the link to that website and article about that in event in history is there for you to read on your own and learn a little bit more about that, that part of history. Today is also Equal Opportunity Day, also known as Gettysburg Address Day. And so I put a link in there to the Gettysburg Address on Wikipedia. So you can take some time to read and listen about the historic event. It's also Rocky and Bullwinkle Day. And so that brought up some funny childhood memories. And so put a link there to 11 things that you should know about Rocky and Bullwinkle, or your children should if they do not already. And it is also World Toilet Day, which sounds kind of silly, but there on this website, worldtoiletday.info, there is a lot of really important information that I was not, I had not thought about the importance of toilets and sanitation and waste management. So hopefully that you find something interesting and worth some new facts to share with the world. Our agreements as we come into our workshop spaces are to protect, uplift, inspire, and empower others, to listen for understanding and take responsibility for any hurts we might cause. We are always committed to being more impactful with our actions and doing better every day. We pause to regather our thoughts or focus if we get off sidetracked and need to get back on track. If you hear something that is worth saving or sharing, you can quote anything that's said by dropping a gem in the chat to save that thought, or keep saving it for yourself when you're sharing the work that we're doing. If there is an opportunity to talk and you don't feel comfortable, you are always welcome to pass. And we always focus on it, trying to use as much sound verbal behavior as possible, as opposed to noxious verbal behavior. Sound verbal behavior are the thoughtful, measured, and deliberate speech. And so let's get down to it. We are ready to really listen, be radical, and take action in our lives using tools of behavioral science. Our values are to act with pride. Act with pride means that we are acting committedly together with precision, respect, integrity, determination, and enthusiasm. And our motto mantra is there for all to see and hear. And I'll go ahead and sing our little ditty because it's always fun to have a song to go with our values, because they keep that, it keeps them closer to in our minds and closer to our hearts. We live resourcefully and sustainably. We embody peace, love, and joy. We effectively advocate for change. We fuel genuine heart connections. We know who we are as a family. We are strong and self-assured. We are confident and motivated. We are happy, vibrant, and full of life. We totally love and accept ourselves. We are enough and all we can be. We are committed to taking action. We act with pride every day. All right. So for our final workshop in the Finding Our Hearts workshop series for our fall term, we have three guiding questions. The first is, how will we ensure effective curriculum and adequate progress? And we're going to be utilizing the ACT matrix to make some decisions around this question. The second question is, what could we do to make our homeschool curriculum more effective and efficient? And we're going to use the PACS tool, Shared Vision, to explore possibilities and establish some expectations. And then we will continue thinking about this overarching guiding question, where do we want to be in 10 years, and take some time to write about one of the time points in that talking series. For our final tool or practice skill exercise to explore a liberated mind and the psychological flexibility development tools that are in, within this book with to teach us how to pivot towards what matters. I wanted to actually walk us through briefly the valued living questionnaire. And so I am going to read the section. There's a couple paragraphs before the valued living questionnaire. And then we're going to just do the questionnaire together. I'll walk us through each one of the questions. There are 12 or each one of the valued areas. And so I'll go ahead and read this section from A Liberated Mind, How to Pivot Towards What Matters. And then we'll do the valued living questionnaire together. This is a really important step within the psychological flexibility development process, because clarifying our values and having a clear understanding for ourselves about what our deepest held values are can help us create goals that are more meaningful to us in our lives and our families, and have clarity around what we really care about, so we are always in tune with that as we're moving through our days and acting in accordance with our values. So I'm going to go ahead and read this section, and then we'll do the questionnaire together. Taking the valued living questionnaire. Another person whose life was transformed by reconnecting with his true values is Kelly Wilson, who entered my lab as a graduate student in the late 1980s and has been an important contributor to the development of ACT methods. Kelly altered the direction of ACT's development to include more emphasis on values. Before pursuing a psychology degree, he had experienced a harrowing struggle with addiction, including lying on a bed in a detox ward in four-point restraints, wondering how he might kill himself. It was only a couple of years after that, as he fought his way from addiction to succeeding in school, when he realized that he wanted to devote his life to helping others overcome psychological challenges. He read some of my early work on ACT and sought me out to help continue to develop it. After getting his degree, he created the Valued Living Questionnaire, or the VLQ. The VLQ asks a series of questions about what your values are and how much you have been living in accordance with them. Evaluating that measure is a set of life domains on a scale of 1 to 10. Taking the VLQ is a good first step in doing ACT values work, and you should fill it out now. It is best to plan not to let anyone see this, so you can answer as honestly as possible, setting aside as best you can social pressures and the wagging mental fingers of should and have to. This is between you and you. So perhaps rather than filling in your answers in this book, download the VLQ, which you can do at my website. There's a number of valued living questionnaires on Stephen Hayes's website. It's stephenchayes.com, and I'll drop that in the chat. If you find you are beating yourself up in the process of filling it in, step back and remind yourself that values are what you choose to work toward, not what the mind says you have to do or care about or else. So the following are domains of life that contain values for some people. We are concerned with your quality of life in each of these areas. One aspect of quality of life involves the importance that one puts on different areas of living. Rate the importance of each area by circling a number. You don't have it, so you'll just write the number. And rate the importance of each area on a scale of 1 to 10. A score of 1 means the area is not at all important, and a score of 10 means the area is very important. Not everyone will have notable values in all of these areas or care about all of the areas the same. Rate each area according to your own personal sense of importance. So if you go ahead and number your paper 1 through 12, and we're going to go through each one of these areas twice. So the first time we're going to be going through it and rating each area in accordance to your personal sense of importance. So from 1 to 10, that it's not important, 1, or it is very important, 10. And then we're going to go through each one a second time and do a similar rating, where a score of 10, where we're actually looking at how consistently you've been acting in accordance with that value, where a score of 1 is not at all, or a score of 10 is completely consistent with that value. And we are not going to be sharing this out. This is for you to do on your own. So number 1 is family other than marriage or parenting. So this is how much do you value family on a scale of 1 to 10? The second is marriage, couples, or intimate relations. On a scale of 1 to 10, how much do you value marriage, couples, or intimate relations? Number 3 is parenting. On a scale of 1 to 10, how much do you value parenting? Number 4 is friends or social life. On a scale of 1 to 10, how much do you value friends or social life? Number 5 is work. On a scale of 1 to 10, how much do you value work? Number 6 is education and training. On a scale of 1 to 10, how much do you value education and training? Number 7 is recreation and fun. On a scale of 10, how much do you value recreation and fun? Number 8 is spirituality. On a scale of 1 to 10, how much do you value spirituality? Number 9 is citizenship or community life. On a scale of 1 to 10, how much do you value citizenship or community life? Number 10 is physical self-care, such as diet, exercise, and sleep. On a scale of 1 to 10, how much do you value physical self-care? Number 11 is environmental issues. On a scale of 1 to 10, how much do you value environmental issues? And finally, number 12 is art, creative expression, and aesthetic. On a scale of 1 to 10, how much do you value art, creative expression, and aesthetics? So then the second part of the valued living questionnaire is to go through those same areas of life where we're looking, where we're kind of evaluating our quality of life in these areas. And the second part is to we're going to rate how consistently our actions have been with our values in each of these domains. So we're not asking about your ideal in each area, and we're also not asking what others think of you. Everyone does better in some areas than others. People also do better at some times than at others. We want to know how you think you have been doing during the past week. Rate each area by circling a number. You'll write down a number 1 to 10. A score of 1 means that your actions have been completely inconsistent with your values in this area. And a score of 10 means that your actions have been completely consistent with your values in this area. So we're going to go through each domain and rate on a scale of 1 to 10, how consistent have your actions been with your values in this area in the past week? Number 1, in the area of family, other than marriage or parenting, how consistent have your actions been with your values? Number 2, in relation to your values around marriage, couples, and intimate relations, in the past week, how consistent have your actions been with your values? Number 3 is parenting. On a scale of 1 to 10, how consistent have your actions been in the past week with your values around parenting? Number 4 is friends and social life. On a scale of 1 to 10, how consistent have your actions been with your values around friends and social life? Number 5 is work. How consistent in the past week have your actions been with your values around work? Number 6, education and training. On a scale of 1 to 10, how consistent have your actions been with your values around education and training? Number 7, recreation and fun. On a scale of 1 to 10, how consistent have your actions been with your values around recreation and fun in the past week? Number 8 is spirituality. On a scale of 1 to 10, how consistent have your actions been with your values around spirituality? Number 9, citizenship and community life. On a scale of 1 to 10, how consistent have your actions been in accordance with your values around citizenship and community life? Number 10, physical self-care, such as diet, exercise, and sleep. On a scale of 1 to 10, how consistent have your actions been with your values this past week? Number 11, environmental issues. In the past week, on a scale of 1 to 10, how consistent have your actions been with your values? And finally, number 12, art, creative expression, and aesthetics. On a scale of 1 to 10, in the past week, how consistent have your actions been with your values? So now that we're done with that, as I mentioned, we're not going to share out. These results are for you, but there's a description of how to utilize this information to help you start getting your actions more in alignment with your values. So there are a number of ways to assess the results. The first is to look at all domains that have relatively high importance scores, such as a score of 9 or 10, and also have relatively low consistency scores, a 6 or less. These are clear problem areas, and I suggest doing your initial values work with any one of them. Then you can move on to the other areas. It is also good to calculate your overall score. Multiply the two numbers from the first and second parts for each domain. So if for family, in the first part you scored a 10, and in the second part you circled 4, for that domain you would get 40. Add all of these numbers and then divide them by 12 to get your composite score. To get a rough sense of how your score compares to those of the broad public, the average composite score result is a 61. Do not begin beating yourself up if your score is lower than that. Practice some diffusion from that negativity. This is a discovery process, not a critique after all. And you've embarked on this journey. Give yourself some credit for that. You're here to embrace change. If you scored quite a few of the domains as low in importance to you, you should consider whether you were being fully honest with yourself about them. It is perfectly reasonable to have domains that are unimportant. You may not care about citizenship or the environment. And if you do not have children, you may not care about the parenting practices of others and so on. That being said, research suggests that if many of these domains are unimportant, that's a contributor to psychological distress. Use this assessment as an opportunity to admit your true values to yourself. Now, with a good idea of the values domains you'd like to start working on, you're ready to get going. And we won't do this here now, but the first exercise suggested for this pivot, which is values, it's values writing, and it would be taking the valued area, maybe one of the ones that score high importance but low consistency, and do a 10-minute free write about those values. All right. So our first guiding question today is, how will we ensure effective curriculum and adequate progress? And we are going to be utilizing the ACT matrix to explore some possibilities around this question. So again, the ACT matrix is a tool that we can use to make shared decisions. So if we were concerned about the efficacy of our curriculum and the adequacy of our progress, and we wanted to come together as a group to make some decisions about that, we could use the ACT matrix as a tool to facilitate that conversation to ensure that everybody has their voice heard. So we're going to start in box 1 in the lower right quadrant, which is priorities, values, and goals. So we're going to go through each area. We're going to take 1 minute to brainstorm and think on our own, and then we will have time to share out and incorporate our perspectives into each of these areas. So we'll go ahead and get started. I'll do 1 minute, 1 minute brainstorm, and then we'll share out. And you can, if you want to share out vocally, you are welcome. If you're more comfortable sharing in text form, that is also perfectly okay. So we'll go ahead and start the timer for 1 minute. What are your priorities, values, and goals in relation to effective curriculum and adequate progress? And please begin. So that was a minute. So now we can share out and add our thoughts to the chart. So what are your priorities, values, and goals around education, and progress. All right. Okay, so for this section, we came up with priorities and values and goals around effective curriculum and adequate progress. Our goals are that we're focused on, our priorities are literacy, and I'll actually change this to global literacy. And by global literacy, this kind of a double entendre. So global literacy is literacy of all people around the globe. And global literacy can also mean literacy in all areas, you know, a whole person approach. So global literacy, other values and priorities are fluency and automaticity. Development of tool skills that can be applied to a variety of areas. We also have priorities, values, and goals around the core academic skills that can be applied in different ways. And other values are related to direct instruction and precision teaching, PACS tools, and self-directed education. Okay. Education. There we go. All right. So our values, priorities, and goals around effective curriculum and adequate progress are global literacy, fluency and automaticity, development of tool skills, core academic skills, direct instruction, precision teaching, PACS tools, and self-directed education. Now we'll move on to box two, which is to identify actions we could take that would move us closer towards our priorities, values, and goals in relation to these areas. So let's go ahead and do a 1 minute brainstorm, and then we'll go ahead and add our contributions to this topic, which is actions that we could take to move us closer towards our priorities, values, and goals. Go ahead and begin. All right, that was our minute. Let's go ahead and add our thoughts about actions we could take to move closer towards our priorities, values, and goals. So let's see. So we came up with that we could conduct placement tests. Okay. Ooh. So if we are curious about what is the best place to place or to start within a curriculum, doing the placement test to get a clear picture of where our learners are at is really an important step to being able to move towards global literacy and fluency and automaticity, actually meeting the student, the learners where they are. Another thing that we could do to make sure that we're moving towards our goals is to get training in direct instruction. Indirect instruction, precision teaching, PACS, and SDE. Another action we could take is to find a coach to support implementation. You are all homeschool families and you are all doing a wonderful job serving the needs of your children and of the learners. And sometimes it's helpful to have somebody, a second set of eyes, another pair of hands to help you overcome any barriers and fine tune your program to ensure it's effective and meeting the needs of your children. And then finally is to regularly progress monitor using standardized tools and measurement systems, such as the standard acceleration chart. And we are really excited to dive into this more during the winter term workshops. All right. Okay. So now let's move on to box three, question three, where we are talking about thinking about actions we might take that would move us away from curriculum that is effective and move us away from making adequate progress. So again, we'll take 1 minute to brainstorm and then add our thoughts. Let's begin. All right, that is the end of our minute. Let's go ahead and add our thoughts to the chart. Okay, so what are some actions that we might engage in that would move us away from our priorities, values, and goals? We came up with no progress monitoring. So just going through it, just blowing through curriculum or blowing through lessons. No matter how good, bad, or otherwise they're going, we're just moving right along. We might be flying by the seat of our pants. We know all how that feels. We might find ourselves going down rabbit holes, kind of unfocused, unorganized exploration, which is not necessarily a bad thing. It just might not get us to our goal of effective curriculum and adequate progress on particular things. But rabbit holes can be very fun to go down. Just ask Alice in Wonderland. We might have lots of input with very little output. So this might look like watching a lot of documentaries, reading a lot, and so there's a lot of receptive language happening, lots of stuff going in, but not a lot going out. And you know, when we're crafting output, that is actually an important step to ensure that we're putting together all of the information in a way that we can talk about, explain, write about. So there's more confidence that we have solid information and knowledge and skills. So now we'll move on to thoughts, feelings, and barriers that would be that we might experience if we were moving away from our priorities, values, and goals. So let's go ahead and take 1 minute to brainstorm some things you might be thinking, feeling, or experiencing if you're moving away from your priorities, values, and goals in regard to effective curriculum and adequate progress. We'll go ahead and start our 1 minute brainstorm now. Please begin. All right, that's the minute. Let's go ahead and share out what came up for us in regard to this question. All right. So we came up with that we might be, if we were moving away from our priorities, values, and goals, we might be feeling or thinking or feeling or experiencing barriers of disorganization, unconfident, unsure, might be a lot of busy work. You might be having thoughts that your kids are just not getting it. Or you might be having thoughts or feelings such as, you know this. I hear that a lot, that kids, you know, kids are not performing things that they might have been taught in the past. And that might be that they weren't fully taught. Or they just don't know. So in review of the ACT matrix, how this is used and how we can utilize this information then to make decisions, we use the ACT matrix to come together with a group around a shared concern to make decisions. We talk about our priorities, values, and goals. And for this question about ensuring our curriculum is effective and progress is adequate for our learners, our values and priorities are global literacy, so literacy in multiple areas, fluency and automaticity of skills, development of tool skills that can be applied to a variety of situations, development of core academic skills, such as reading, writing, math, and language, and using direct instruction and precision teaching, PACS tools, and self-directed education. Those are our values. Things that we can do to get more in alignment with those values are conduct placement tests, get training in direct instruction, precision teaching, PACS, and self-directed education, find a coach to support your implementation, and regularly progress monitor using standardized tools and measurement systems, such as the standard acceleration chart. And I'm just gonna go ahead and add in here for the record, Easy CBM. Because those are, that's another set of really important tools for progress monitoring. Some actions that we might be engaging in that are moving away from our priorities, values, and goals are not progress monitoring, just blowing through lessons, flying by the seat of our pants, not really necessarily having a plan, going down rabbit holes in an unfocused and unorganized way, and engaging in lots of input activities. So consuming a lot of information, but not necessarily processing and engaging in the output that demonstrates your comprehension and ability to apply those things that you're learning. Some thoughts that we might be having if we're moving away from our values, that we might be feeling or disorganized, unconfident, unsure, and that we're doing a lot of busy work and that feel like our kids aren't getting it and that they're not showing what they're knowing, or maybe that they're just thinking that they don't know and don't know the things at all. And so that can give us a clue that we need to do more of the actions that are going to, that we've come up with that would get us closer to our priorities, values, and goals. So I hope that you can see how useful this tool can be for just quickly and, you know, within 10, 15 minutes, getting out some really deep thoughts about these situations so we can move to the next step, which is making decisions about what will we do. All right, friends, it's time for our second guiding question. What could we do to make our homeschool curriculum more effective and more efficient? So we're going to utilize the PACS tool shared vision to explore possibilities and make some decisions utilizing this conversation tool. This conversation tool is really, really useful when we are experiencing frequent challenges or having things happen repeatedly, and we need to come together as a family, as a community, to have a conversation and establish clear expectations of ourselves and each other. So the way that this PACS shared vision tool works is that we will first think and talk about what we would like to see, feel, hear, and do more of, or what we would see, feel, hear, and do more of if our homeschool curriculum was more effective and efficient. And then the second part of this is to brainstorm and share our perspectives in regard to what we would see less of if our homeschool curriculum was more effective and efficient. For this one, we could go one box at a time, brainstorm each one, and then add our thoughts, or we can brainstorm one big, kind of the big section at a time, which is what we're going to do today. I'm going to set a timer for 3 minutes, give us 3 minutes of independent think time, and then we'll share out our perspectives. So our first question is, I'm going to restate it into a statement as your thinking prompt and give us 3 minutes to brainstorm. So the statement is, if our homeschool curriculum was more effective and efficient, we would see, feel, hear, and do more blank. I'm going to go ahead and put 3 minutes on the clock for us to brainstorm, and then we'll come back together and share out our thoughts. Please begin. All right, that is the end of our 3 minutes of think time. So now let's go ahead and share out our thoughts. If our homeschool curriculum was more effective and efficient, we would see more progress, engagement, learning pictures, and data charts. If our homeschool curriculum was more effective and efficient, we would feel more pride, focused, successful, and accomplished. If our homeschool curriculum was more effective and efficient, we would hear more cheering, writing, kudos, and positive self-talk. Okay, there we go. And if our homeschool curriculum was more effective and more efficient, we would do more celebrating and sharing and expressing gratitude and fun stuff. Because if you get all of the important stuff done more effectively and more efficiently, that means we're doing things more quickly, and then we have more time for the good stuff, which is what life is all about, or at least I think it should be. Okay, so let's now explore the second part of the PACS tool shared vision, which is less. If our homeschool curriculum was more effective and more efficient, we would see, feel, hear, and do less blank. I'm going to go ahead and give us 3 minutes of independent think time, and then we will share out. Let's begin. All righty, that is our 3 minutes. Now we will go ahead and share out our thoughts that we came up with about this part. So as a reminder, with the PAX tool shared vision, it is really important that we make sure that the number of items in our less section are less than the number of items in our more section. So we have four thoughts or ideas in each of the more sections. And so we're going to limit our lesses to two each. Okay. So if our homeschool curriculum was more effective and more efficient, we would see less unfinished work. And we would see less unmotivated kids. If our homeschool curriculum was more effective and more efficient, we would feel less frustrated and overwhelmed. If our homeschool curriculum was more effective and more efficient, we would hear more, or sorry, we would hear less negative self-talk and we would hear less yawning. And finally, if our homeschool curriculum was more effective and more efficient, we would do less guessing and we would do more with less. Hopefully that makes sense. Okay. So, in summary, we use the PAX tool shared vision to come together as a family or as a community to share to talk about a shared concern and establish some expectations of ourselves and each other so we can hold each other accountable for doing more of the good stuff and doing less of the not so good stuff. So for this question, what could we do to make our homeschool curriculum more effective and more efficient? We said that if it was more effective and more efficient, we would see more progress, engagement, learning pictures, and data charts. We would feel more pride, focused, successful, and accomplished. We would hear more cheering, writing, kudos, and positive self-talk. And we would do more celebrating, sharing, expressions of gratitude, and fun stuff. And then we also said that if our homeschool curriculum was more effective and more efficient, we would see less unfinished work and unmotivated kids. We would feel less frustrated and overwhelmed. We would hear less negative self-talk and yawning, and we would do less guessing, and we would do more with less. We would do more things with less time. So hopefully that was a good exercise for you to begin to see, number one, how this tool is used and think about how it might apply to your own life. And hopefully you got some good ideas for yourself on how you can make your homeschool curriculum more effective, more efficient too. All right, friends, last but not least, we are on to the question of where do we want to be in 10 years? So this is a really, really good way to kind of open up possibilities by exploring what you want to see in your future self. So by writing the story of your future self, you can kind of explore ideas of how you can get from where you are now to where you want to be in the future. So today I encourage you to choose any one of these STEM sentences, and we're going to take 3 minutes to write about our thoughts and then share out if you feel comfortable. So you can choose to write about what you will be or where you'll be in, or what you will be doing in 10 years, what you'll be doing in 5 years, what you'll be doing in 3 years, what you will be doing in 1 year, what you will be doing in the next 3 months, what you'll be doing next month, and what you will be doing next week. So take a moment to choose which one you want to do, and then we'll have 3 minutes to free write, and then we can share out if you're comfortable. Let's go ahead and begin. All right. I hope that gave you enough time to at least get started on this story of your future self. And I encourage you to commit to writing that story of your future self right now, that as the calendar year is coming to a close, this is a really good time to think about where we want to be in 10 years and what we can do in the coming year to move ever closer to those who are deeply held values, priorities, and goals. I'll go ahead and share my thoughts, where I am going to be or what I'm going to be doing. And I decided to do the in the next month, I will stem sentence. And so for me, in the next month, I will be sharing details about our winter and spring workshops, begin marketing and enrolling people in our learning community. We will celebrate the holidays with family and friends and reconnect and share stories. I am planning to uplift, empower, and inspire others. Get ready to move into our tiny house because it is most definitely winter. It snowed on ground level here today for the first time. And that's actually sticking. And we are going to get even more focused, more centered, and more organized so we can execute upon our plans. I hope that you all are just as excited as I am for winter. All right, friends, we are closing out our workshop for today. Thank you so much for joining us for our fall workshop series, Finding Our Hearts. It has been a wonderful journey exploring with you how to utilize the two tools that we've really been focused on this term, which are the ACT Matrix and the PAX tool Shared Vision. I'm really excited to begin sharing with you in the winter and spring terms, diving deeper into direct instruction and precision teaching, diving deeper into our PAX tools. We've really been focused on shared vision because that is one of the most important PAX tools to get a strong understanding of and how to use. And we'll be diving into some more PAX tools in the coming months. And we'll also be continuing to explore self-directed education and what that can look like for you and your family. You are all invited to join our Alaskan Oasis Homeschool Collective if you are not already a member. You can join us for $100 per term or $270 per year. We are available for weekly family coaching. We are offering 10 to 15 hours of coaching services for $750. And we also have available daily direct instruction for your learners. If you need an extra set of eyes and hands, we're offering 40 to 60 hours of direct instruction for $1,500. If you are feeling in the giving mood, we would love to have some contributions to our GoFundMe to support our Alaskan Oasis. Our goal is to raise $13,000 to purchase direct instruction curriculum and testing kits to ensure that we're able to reach as many families as possible with direct instruction and precision teaching. And if you are so motivated, feel free to like, comment, and share on our social channels on Facebook at Cruising with Babs, Instagram at Our Alaskan Oasis, and on TikTok at Mistra the Mysterious Elf. Thank you all for joining us, and I look forward to seeing you in the winter term when we are going to do a deep dive into precision teaching, behavioral objectives, behavior management, direct instruction, and directed and independent practice I am really, really excited, and I hope you are too. Thank you, and we'll see you soon. Have a wonderful, wonderful holiday season.